Hi, my name is Lisa Claxton, and today we're going to be making the basket weave wire centerpiece pendant. My interest in wire lies mostly with textile techniques. I enjoy knitting, crocheting, and weaving with wire. Today's pendant incorporates the weaving. We're also going to learn different structure forms and wire wrapping. I hope you have a great time making this piece. These are the tools we'll be using in today's project. I have a chain nose plier. I have my round nose pliers. I have my flush wire cutter. I prefer using the Tronix plier, mainly because throughout the piece I have a lot of small wire ends that we've only wrapped around one time, and I need to trim those right up against the piece so they won't scratch. We also use a nylon jaw wire straightener, and we use painter's tape. The painter's tape is used throughout the piece to hold our piece so that our spacer bars don't slip off. I prefer to use painter's tape or electrical tape or masking tape. I avoid using packing tape or scotch tape, as those tend to leave a sticky residue on our wire. A quick note about your nylon jaw wire straighteners. We are usually using these to straighten the kinks out of our wire. Over time, using heavier gauge wires, we start to get ruts into the jaws of our teeth. To avoid this, you always want to run your finer gauges, which would be 24 gauge or smaller, at an angle to the jaw as opposed to straight across. I'll demo this for you. So you'll see how I'm holding my 26 gauge wire at an angle on the plier. So this way, when I grab on and pull it through, it won't get caught in any of the ruts made by my heavier gauges. Usually you can avoid using your wire straighteners on wire that is just slightly bent. If you have just a small bend in your wire, it's easiest to use your fingers to straighten out that wire, as use of the wire straightener does harden your wire. These are the materials we'll be using to make today's pendant. I have two types of head pins. The first is a 3-inch, 22-gauge hard wire head pin. I prefer to use hard head pins as opposed to 22-gauge wire because it helps to hold the shape of our pendant. I also have 5 smaller head pins. These are used for the bottom of our piece to add embellishment. We also have 2 5-strand spacer bars. These spacer bars are used to space out our head pins in the original construction of our piece. The spacer bars are optional as to the number of holes that you have, as well as the size. I prefer the larger size for the first piece, as it's a little bit easier to weave in between the wires that are separated a bit further apart. You'll notice that these bars have nice spacing in between each of the holes. I have a collection of small sterling silver spacer beads. These beads are used to embellish the crown of our piece as well as the bottom fringe. These beads are flexible as to size and shape. You can really mix in onesies here and there. They don't all have to match. Usually when I'm creating my piece, I play with my entire collection to see what will fit best. I have my centerpiece bead here. This bead is pretty flexible as to the shape and size that you use. I do, however, prefer to work with an oval shaped, as it makes it much easier to do the wire wrapping on either side. I like larger beads, things that are really going to set off the center of my piece when it's framed with silver wire. It's also very important that all of your beads fit onto these larger 22 gauge head pins. I've collected several different types of beads to act as embellishment. I like to play off the color of my original centerpiece bead and then add different colors to give myself accent. The shape and size is flexible. Throughout the piece, you'll be able to play with different textures. It's one of the biggest things I look for in my selection of beads. You'll notice here I have 2 different sizes of faceted rondelle stone beads. I also have 2 different 4mm beads, one of which is plain and the other one is faceted. This is going to give my finished design a little bit more texture and also give me different light reflection. You'll also need approximately 6 feet of 26 gauge fine silver wire. It's important here that you use the fine silver wire as opposed to sterling silver, as fine silver wire tends to work harden at a slower rate, since we will be weaving our 26 gauge wire over and under our heavier head pins. While you're designing this piece, you may also come across different beads within your selection that you just have one or two of. This project is great to add those beads into this piece, as you don't have to have multiples of each bead. You can always just use one here and one there. So just to give you a little idea of what we're about to do on this project, I have the before and after. You'll see that the structure of my piece is topped and bottomed with my spacer bars. I've used my 3-inch head pins to run the length in between each of the spacer bars. In between that space, we'll be weaving with our 26 gauge wire, wrapping, and then weaving again. Before we can begin this project, however, we need to start by designing the top of our piece. This is called the crown. I'm going to begin by taking one of my 22 gauge wire head pins and snipping the head off the end of that wire. The reason I prefer using a head pin over 22 gauge half hard wire is that the head pins are very stiff. If you push on it with your finger, you can't even make it bend. Having a stiff wire on the outside edges of our piece is essential, as we don't want the two sides to cave in as we weave our rows. I'm going to go ahead and use my round nose pliers to make a loop on the end of this wire. This loop is what I'll be using to attach my chain or necklace to my pendant. To ensure that all of my loops are the same size throughout this piece, I can make a little mark on my tool using a Sharpie. And I'm just going to mark the tooth of the tool. And this will give me a line so that I'll know where to make each loop throughout the piece. When designing the crown of this pendant, you'll want to play by using a lot of different style of beads. You'll notice on the ones I have here, I have two different kinds of daisy spacers. I've also used a machine-made square sterling bead. I have two different kinds of rondelles, as well as two different kinds of 4mm beads. When designing your crown, go ahead and take the time you need to get a design that you're happy with. It's always easy to underestimate the amount of time design can take. This is the top of our piece. This is one of the first things that people notice when they look at our pendant. I really want to spend the time here. Make sure I like how the colors play with each other. Make sure I like how much there is. I like having a lot of different spacer beads mixed in here. I like the different shapes, the different sizes, so it really creates texture to my piece. Now we're going to go ahead and string it onto our spacer bar and see how that looks. I never really know how it's going to look until I have the actual head pins going through my spacer bar. One thing that you'll notice right away is that my center head pin is a little bit higher than the ones on either side. I've also had to step the beads, and what that means is right down here at the bottom of my center head pin, I have a small 4mm bead. This bead was needed so that I would have room, have the clearance, to put on these two larger rondelles. Had I not used the smaller bead here, the large amethyst rondelle wouldn't have fit. You'll notice on my final ones, the two outside head pins are the head pins that I cut the head off and made a loop. These beads also require that I put a small daisy spacer down here to lift this 4 millimeter bead up just enough to clear the edge of my jade rondelle. After I think I like my crown, I'm going to go ahead and string it all on and take a final look at it to make decisions. Do I want to add more beads, take some off? Should it be higher, maybe shorter? I'm going to warn you against making your center head pin too long. I usually stick to about a half an inch of beads. Anything longer than that over time can bend when you're wearing the necklace. So our next step is our first segment of basket weave wire wrapping. Before we can begin, we need to go ahead and start by putting on our second spacer bar. I've strung it through all 5 head pins, and to secure it to the piece so that it doesn't fall off, I'm going to introduce a piece of painter's tape, and I'm going to be taping directly below the spacer bar. When you go to apply your tape, you're going to gently lay it down onto your head pins. One thing that I want to make sure is that the top of my head pins, none of the wires are sticking out farther. I want it nice and tight up at the top. I'm going to lay my painter's tape across the 5 head pins and then fold it over so the tape covers the back side. If it's not perfectly even, that's fine. We're just using the tape so that this spacer bar down on the bottom doesn't fall off, and I don't have to worry about any of my head pins coming loose. The basket weave is created by using about 2 feet of the 26 gauge fine silver wire. Our head pins are going to act as our warp wires for this project, and our 26 gauge wire is going to act as the weft. The weft is the wire that runs over and under our warp wires. In traditional weaving, there's a product called a shed, and on large looms, you'll find a shed is almost like a comb. So once you've woven across your piece, you can then take the shed and push it up against your row, so it'll make it nice and tight and straight. That's what our bottom spacer bar is for. Throughout weaving, at the end of each row, we'll use this bottom spacer bar to push up tight against our previous row, so it'll make a nice straight line and keep all of our weaving compact. To begin the basket weave, you're going to cut a length that's about 2 feet long of the 26 gauge wire. Connect it to your piece with one single wire wrap around one of the outside wires. So here I'm just going to feed a little bit through and take my wire tail and wrap it tightly around one of the outside head pins. Just one time, nice and tight. I'm going to come in here and tighten all this up. Now in this case, I notice that my end of my 26 gauge wire is coming over the outside head pin. My goal here is to have my 26 gauge wire run over and then under, over, then under, and back over my final outside head pin. To do this, I don't want to feed the tail of my wire down through my head pins. If I do this, the chances of my wire kinking are pretty high. In order to avoid kinks, I push the wire up through in between the head pins and then pull the length of the wire through. Now I'm going to push it down through the next 2 head pins, pull the wire through, and then up through the next head pins, and I pull it through. When I reach the end of my row, I'm going to take the bottom spacer bar and I'm going to push it up against the top spacer bar so it's nice and tight. You'll see this helped to straighten my row. And on the sides of my piece, I want to make sure that I have nice tight wrapping, but that the outside wires don't get pulled inward. In order to keep that from happening and still be able to do each row tight, I hold my spacer bar tied up against the last row in place, and then I bring this 26 gauge wire a half turn around the outside head pin. You'll see when I pull my spacer bar away that I have a nice tight wrap right up against the side here, and I can now start my next row. The next row is done the exact same way. I'm just going to push the wire up in between, pull it through, push the wire down between the next two, pull the wire through. The temptation to feed the end of your wire in between these head pins is pretty great, but you will always get a kink. So it's very important to remember, always feed the wire down and up between the head pins and then pull the length of the wire through. When I get to the end of the row, I'm going to repeat the process of pushing the spacer bar up. I pull that wire and I'm pulling slightly outward away from the piece. This will guarantee I'll get a nice tight row, and while holding the spacer bar in place, I can bring the wire back around in position to weave my next row. I'm going to repeat this exact same process about a minimum of 10 times. I prefer to have about 16 rows of weaving, and that's 16 counting one across, then two across, three across, back and forth. And that'll give me a good amount of weaving to really play off my centerpiece bead. Now I'm just going to continue weaving a few rows. You'll remember we push the wire down in between the spacer bars, just about an inch away from the piece, and then pull the length of our wire through. Then I push up, and you'll notice how I'm really using this length here that I have in between my spacer bars. So that way it's really easy to push that wire up in between. Now I'm going to push the wire down, so I'm alternating each time. I'm paying close attention to make sure that I've alternated each time. If I go straight across and I'm going over two head pins, that will show up in my pattern. And I'm going to go up, and then at the end of the row, I always push that spacer bar up against the row I just completed, and I'm going to grab onto the 26 gauge wire and ever so slightly pull it outward to straighten the row, and then bring it around the outside edge of my head pin. Then I can scoot that spacer bar out of the way and go ahead and weave my next row. So I'm going to go up, then I'm going to push the wire down. Come back up through and push the wire down. Over time, this process gets much faster. In the beginning, it may take you a while. Once you've gotten pretty good at it, this step should only take you about 10 minutes. So I'm going to push that spacer bar up. I'm going to pull the outside wire. And I'm going to go back around the edge. You'll notice that I'm just now starting to get a little of the basket weave look. Once you've woven about 16 rows, you're then ready to go ahead and finish this wire off. To finish it off, I'm going to make sure my rows are nice and tight, and I do that just by pushing the bottom spacer bar up against my weaving. Now I can pull it away. You'll notice as soon as I pulled the spacer bar away, the weave loosened. That's nothing to worry about. At any time, your weave can actually completely come apart. But then we can always fix just by pushing up against our spacer bar. At the very end of the piece, we make sure it's nice and tight by pulling the ends of each of the head pins. So as you're working this, if it does loosen just a little bit, there's nothing to worry about. To finish off the 26 gauge wire, you just need to take that final end and wire wrap it one time around the outside head pin. I always like to alternate, so if I begin on one side, I always like to end my wire on the opposite side. This will keep my sides from building up too many wire wraps. So to wire wrap it around, just hold on to your weave and feed the wire through. One time, nice and tight, is all you need to hold the wire wrap in place. I want to make sure it's nice and tight though. If I end up with a baggy loop on the end here, it might come out later on. I also like to leave my wire tails. Now this is done primarily so that throughout working the piece, if I need to make adjustments or I have exposed wire anywhere, I can always go and wrap around a couple more times. It's up to you, that's pretty optional. Usually what I do is I cut it down so it's about an inch long, and then I just wrap it around both wires, push it to the back side of my piece. So the back side of my piece will have the little wire tails, so as I'm looking at my design, they won't get in the way. Before we can begin the next step, we need to go ahead and remove our tape and remove our spacer bar and string on our centerpiece bead. When you go to remove your tape, usually you can just gently pull on it and it'll come right off. And a lot of times you have a sticky residue down here at the bottom. If that's the case, you can often just run your fingers across to remove that. If you need to, at the very end of the piece, we can always put rubbing alcohol on these wires and that'll remove any stickiness. So now you can just pull your spacer bar off. Go ahead and string your centerpiece bead onto the center head pin. And you'll notice it doesn't fit in place. But I'm gonna now go ahead to keep that centerpiece bead in place for the moment. I'm gonna go ahead and string on my second spacer bar. So I'm gonna put this right back on. And once I have that on, I'm then gonna go ahead and apply a new piece of tape. This just keeps everything from falling off. And I'm now ready to do the next step in which I make room for the centerpiece bead. The next step of the pendant is to go ahead and create a frame for our centerpiece bead. This is done by pulling away our next two last head pins. You'll notice there's a little space on either side. And then wire wrapping those two outside head pins together to create a solid wire frame. So now we need to make room for the centerpiece bead so that it can lay flat in the center here and also spin. In order to do that, I need to pull these wires that are on either side of my centerpiece bead out and away from the center and toward the outside edges. To do this, the easiest way is to hold the center bead in place. I want to make sure everything is nice and tight, so I'm really pushing against this spacer bar here. If when you're pushing against the spacer bar you feel like it's taking too much of your attention to hold it tight, you can always adjust your tape, so it's a little bit tighter there. I need to make sure before I do anything that my head pin wires are pushed in all the way. If I have any excess wire up here at the top of my crown, it's going to stay there. There's no way to pull it tighter at the end. So I want to make sure the head of the head pin is nice and flush to the top of my bead. Now I'm going to pick up my chain nose plier. What I'm going to be doing is grabbing on to the head pin wire right in the very center, lined up to the center of the centerpiece bead. And I'm going to bend the wire with the chain nose so that it makes about a 45 degree angle. So you'll see right here I line it up, and whether you bend it up or down doesn't matter. If you're off center a little, that's fine. As long as you make the second side match the first side, then everything looks as it's supposed to. So I'm going to go ahead and do my bend, grab on, and I'm going to bend the wire outward. You'll notice I'm doing this very slowly. I want to make sure the wire is going where I want it to. And when I release, you'll see I now have a bend. I often think of this as kind of an opened curtain. And if I want to make any adjustments to this, I can come in with my chain nose pliers and straighten it up. And now I want to do the same on the second side. So to match that up, I'm going to do the exact same technique. This time I'm going to come from the back side so you can watch my pliers. I'm going to grab on. And what I think is aligned with the bend of my other side, my first side, and I'm going to tweak my chain nose pliers. Oops. And this is a little hard because my tape down at the bottom is trying to hold this wire in place. I'm going to just gently tweak that. So now I have my two sides, and you'll see I'm completely off. So if I wanted this to be my final design, I could always pretend I meant to do that. But in this case, I'm going for symmetrical. So if when you do it, you're a little bit off sides, it's not a problem. You can fix it. You can always just go in. I'm going to lower this first side I did. I'm just going to go in here and straighten where I made my bend. And try and bend just a little bit lower. So you'll see with that slight adjustment, I got it pretty close. You'll also notice that these head pin wires are trying to push forward. For example, right here, it's trying to come forward. That's going to happen right up until the time when we wrap these wires. So for the time being, when you're trying to gauge how good it looks, just go ahead and use your fingers to push the sides down to see if you've gotten it as symmetrical as you can. It's easy to spend a lot of time working on this to get exact bends. You'll see I'm still off just a little bit. And I can continue working on it. I also know, though, that once I begin doing my wrap, a lot of times, most of these little imperfections are hidden. So for the next step, you'll notice I've removed my centerpiece bead. A lot of times when I'm doing this wrapping, the centerpiece bead just gets in the way. So I'll remove it, I'll put the spacer bar back on, and tape it just like it was before. This allows me a lot of room in the center to get my wire in between so I can wrap these side segments. To begin wrapping, you're going to use a 18-inch piece of 26-gauge fine silver wire. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to start at the smallest point of the weave. And I'm going to do about 5 or 6 wraps, and then I'm going to wrap up on one side and down on the other. To make this work, I need to take my 26 gauge wire and bend it in half at the center point. Once I've bent it in half, I can then feed it onto the smallest point of my side wraps. Now I need to do several wraps by hand before I can use a tool to help me hold this. So I'm just going to hold this tight. And I'm going to feed my wire through. I feed the end. I'm going to be wrapping down right now. I'll feed the wire end through. And I'm going to pull it tight. Now, one thing you'll also want to notice is we do have kind of a flat surface on our wrap. To maintain that, I'm going to get myself about 4 good wraps. And then I'm going to have to change my wrapping style. So there's 2, and here's a 4th wrap. So this is enough to now secure my 26 gauge wire to my piece. To assist me in wrapping further down, I'm going to use my nylon jaw wire straighteners. These wire straighteners can grab onto my wire work, and I don't have to worry about marring my wire down below. I want to make sure I don't death grip this, so I don't really want to grab onto it. I just want to gently hold on to my centerpiece with the wire straighteners in hand, and now it leaves me free to use my other hand to go ahead and continue feeding the wire through to wrap downward. Now, in order to get my wrap so it will wrap flat across the front and the back, as opposed to cupping it around, I'm going to go ahead and treat it like I'm working on a squared object. And what that means is I'm going to bring my wire straight down across the outside, and then I'm going to go ahead and feed my wire through. This is going to wrap around the back side. And then I'm going to bring it straight up against the inside wire, then flat across the front, and then down the side. You'll notice rather than just wrapping around and around and around, I'm really kind of making four sides. So I went down the side, I'm going to pull my wire through, go across the back, up to the front, across the front, down the back, and I'm going to continue this process until I get down to the bottom spacer bar. But by now your fingers are probably getting a little bit sore from all this wire work, and so using the wire straighteners is just a nice little cheat to give your fingers a break. Sometimes I find that in the beginning I won't use it, but when I get to the second side I'll need that wire straightener just to give my fingertips a bit of a break. Something that your wire will want to do, especially when you're holding it with your hands, is it will always want to just keep pushing up and up. So it can be helpful if you feel like your wrap is just keep pushing up and building upward instead of building downward like we intend. You can just put your nails right up against where your wrap is, and that way it won't slide upward anymore. Your wire, the 26 gauge, will start to work harden in this wrapping process. So as you get a little closer toward the bottom of your wrap, you will find it stiffens up on you quite a bit. I'm just going to continue in this manner until I reach the bottom. Now, because my centerpiece bead is no longer on my piece, I don't necessarily know where the bottom is. So what I'll do is I'm just kind of gauging, and the top and the bottom will end up being the same length. And before I finish any wires off, I'll be sliding my centerpiece back on so I can make sure that the wrapping is in alignment with the bottom of the bead. Once I've wrapped downwards to the length that I think I'm going to need, I can then go ahead and continue wrapping upwards towards the top where my basket weave is. To do this, I want to make sure I wrap nice and tight, so I'm going to kind of pull on my basket weave just a little bit. Luckily, I do have a little wire tail end here that I can use to kind of tug on to bring my basket weave up. This shows me I have room to do a couple more weaves, so I'm just going to continue with my wire. I want to fill this whole pendant in. I don't want there to be any place where I could have had an extra wire wrap or two. I'm just going to continue wrapping. And now I think I'm probably ready to finish it off, as I've run out of room on the outside. You'll notice, however, though, on the inside, you have a little bit of space here. That space can be used to wire wrap around to finish off your tail end. To do this, just take the end of your wire and feed it down through. And you're going to have to go slow with this because your wire is a little bit work hardened. You're just going to feed it in the little space between the wrap and the basket weave. When you turn it over, You can then pull that wire all the way through. I do need to make sure though that my wrap here does not come apart. So I'm just gonna kind of grab onto that wrap, and I'm gonna use a little force to pull this wire nice and tight through. And it looks like on the back, I caught my anchor wire from my basket weave. That was my ending wire. So before I pull that tight, I want to go ahead and fix that up. It's one of the hazards that we have of leaving our little wire tails, so that you never know when you might catch one. So I'm just going to use my round nose here. And I'm going to hope that I can back it out of there. No problem. Just backs right out. I don't have to worry about marring that tail. It's probably something I'm going to cut off, but I leave it there just in case. And now I can continue pulling on my wire. So now it's nice and tight. And I can go ahead and cut this wire off. So when I cut, I have the choice. Either I can just cut it off or I can leave a little tail. I like to leave little tails so that just in case I have room for another wrap later on, I can do that. And I'm going to go ahead and push that little tail around to the back, get it out of my way. And at this point, my bottom wire will be finished the same way, but I'm going to wait until I've wrapped my other side, put the centerpiece on, and then I make sure that this is actually where I want it to end. Now something else I have the ability to do here is you'll notice that my wrap here on the side is actually pretty flat. But if I do want to flatten it out just a little bit more, I can pick up my wire straighteners and I can gently close the teeth of the tool around that wire work. It's gently compressing my wrap. And oftentimes it will flatten it out just a little bit more for you, give you a nice flat side to your wrap. Now I'm ready to repeat this process on the other side. One thing that's really important to notice here though is this final eye pin here on the outside. You'll notice how while working the piece, it's now standing up. Before I can do my wrapping, I need to make sure that I pull that down so it's nice and flush up against my bead. Otherwise, when I finish the piece, I'll have an excess of wire coming out of the top. If I need to, I may need to remove the tape at this point so I can adjust that wire before I begin wrapping my second side. When working your basket weave, there's a lot of mistakes and flubs that can happen. One thing that's important to know is that you can always rig your piece. So if you've done something horrible and you have to take the piece apart, there are ways to do it. Once you've wrapped your side wires, your head pins that are connected to those side wires won't move, so you can't pull those out. But if halfway through I decide I want to change my beads up on the top, you can do that. This also works if, say, your wire breaks down here at the bottom. And in order to do that, you want to remove your spacer bar and ever so gently pull on your head pin. And what you're going to be doing is you're going to be pulling on it so that it slides out of your basket weave itself. Now, if you need to make any changes here, if you need to put beads on, take beads off, use a new pin, you'll go ahead and do those. And then we're going to feed it back through the weave. So if you look in close here, if I look close, I can see that I still have that up-down position of my wire. So long as I don't put my fingers on it and smash it, the wire is still going to have a nice kind of curve of going up and down. So what I want to do is I want to feed the end of the head pin so that it follows that pattern. And it's almost like there's a little tube in there. And oftentimes it's when you get right to the very end that it's hard to stick through, but once you get it through, you can then just string on your new head pin or bead, and then you're ready to keep working on your piece. So now that we have finished our first side and our second side, you're now ready to go ahead and put your centerpiece bead on. I always like to follow it by putting my spacer bar back on. So that way it really gives me a good determination if my length down here at the bottom is correct. There's a little bit of adjustment that you're able to do once we start our weaving. So if you're just a little bit off, which you can see on this piece here, right over here, I ended just a little bit short. And that's going to be fine. I'm not going to worry about that little space right there because I know once I start weaving, it's going to go ahead and get absorbed. My biggest concern was the top of each side to make sure that the weaving was nice and even right with that basket weave. If by chance I did a little bit too much weaving, I can always add in a little spacer bead right at the top or the bottom that can act as an accent but also allow me to not have to rip out the work I've already done. So when I've finished and I've decided my lengths are good, I'm going to go ahead and finish the bottom wires exactly the same way as I did the top, just by wrapping them around the inside wire. I've already done that on this piece. And if I pull that spacer down, I'll turn it over. You can see where I have my leftover tail wires here that have wrapped around the inside wire on each side. Just one single tight wire wrap is just enough to hold it in place. And now I'm ready to start my basket weaving for my next section. So now that we've completed the wrapping on each side and secured all the wire ends, we're now ready to start our basket weaving on the bottom half of our pendant. The basket weave for this next section is going to fit in between my bottom spacer bar and the bottom of my wraps and my centerpiece bead. So I'm going to start by taking a piece of 26 gauge wire, preferably about 18 inches to 2 feet. Now in this case, our shed, we're still going to be using our spacer bar to act as a shed. But one thing I want you to notice is how at the bottom, because we bent these side wires just a little bit, it's now made all of my wires, head pin wires, kind of go higgledy-piggledy here. What I want to do to straighten those out is pull that spacer bar down. So we'll straighten out these head pins, and now I'm going to take a piece of tape and tape. This will keep my spacer bar from falling off, but at the same time, it's going to help hold these wires straight for my weaving. I'm going to push my centerpiece bead in place. It will stay in place after my first row. I'm going to start my wire the same way I started before, just by wrapping a small tail end around the outside wire, one complete turn. And now I'm going to be weaving in the same manner that I did before on the top basket weave portion. So I'm going to start, I see my wire is coming over. And now I'm going to go under. One thing you'll notice right away in doing this is you have substantially less space to push your wire over and under. This is why we're working with 3-inch head pins. In the end, we will be cutting off quite a bit of the head pin, but I want as long a length as I can get so that I can really get this wire up in between each of the head pins. The same as before, I'm going to push my spacer bar up against the wrapping and the bead. I'm going to pull the row tight and then bring my wire around the outside edge. So it's just gone around here. Now this piece that I'm working on here is pretty centered, but a lot of times you'll find that your first few rows, your wires right here, the inside wires that we moved, might not come straight down. If that's the case, it's fine. And at the end of this lesson, we'll look at several other examples of what can happen when you're working up these pendants. Now you'll see I've just fed the tail of the wire down through. Oftentimes, once you start running out of space here, you end up having to feed the tail through. If you do that, you need to watch closely the wire that's coming out of your piece to make sure that it doesn't kink. So the key to doing that is to go slow. So I'm going to continue working the basket weave the same way that we did before on the top half until I get my desired length. Usually I like to do the same amount of weaving on the top and the bottom of the bead. I'm going to pull it tight, move that little tail out of the way, and come around for my next row. Once you've completed your second section of basket weave, you're then ready to finish off your piece. Shown here is a completed piece. You'll notice that I have a lot of different dangles coming off that are all incorporating the same beads that we used on the top crown of our piece. Something else I want to point out though is you'll notice that where my loops begin on the basket weave for the embellishment, I have strung some beads on prior to making the loop. You can always make a mini crown on the inverse side, so down here on the bottom, just by stringing a few beads on. One of the benefits of doing that is it means that each loop of my piece is at a different height. So in the end, the dangles themselves can be tapered or not, depending on the final embellishment that I string on. Next, I'll show you how to finish your piece and make those loops. So then, now that I've finished this final basket weave, I'm now ready to finish off my piece. You'll see I've pulled off the tape. I'm also going to run my fingers along these head pins. I'm going to make sure there's no sticky residue. If there is, you can just use a little bit of rubbing alcohol and that will remove it for you. I'm now ready to finish off my loops at the end. I could finish just by making a loop right down at the bottom of each one, but I like to add a little bit more to the finishing. I want it to kind of blend with that design up on the top. So I always string beads down on the bottom. I'm going to start by taking a larger bead and stringing it onto my middle head pin wire. I like to always finish with the middle first, and then I work outward. So now that I've strung on this one bead, I'm now going to pick up my chain nose pliers and I'm going to grab onto the end of my head pin wire. What I want to do is I want to tighten up this whole piece. I want to get all these wires nice and tight so there's no gaps, such as right here. And to do that, I'm going to grab onto the piece, the spacer bar and my bead, and I'm going to push down. At the same time, I'm going to be pulling upward with my chain nose pliers, and I am holding the piece upside down right now. And then once I have it nice and tight, I'm going to bend the wire to a right angle against the top of my bead. So I'm going to push down on the spacer bar and the bead. And I'm kind of gently pulling up on the head pin wire, and now I'm going to bend a right angle up against the top of the bead. And now I can just trim that wire off. And I'm going for, it's a little over a quarter of an inch. I can cut that wire and then I can pick up my round nose pliers. And I'm going to grab on to the very end of the wire. And you'll remember earlier we made a mark on our pliers. So I'm going to use that mark as my reference point. So all my loops on this piece will be the same. And grabbing onto the end of the wire, so that there's no wire sticking out on the other side. I'm then going to roll my tool. So I'm going to get a finished loop. I'm now going to repeat this process with my next wires. And on these, I also want to continue stringing on beads. So this time I'm stringing on a slightly smaller bead. It's about a 4 millimeter machine made square bead. And I'm going to do the same process where I pick up my chain nose pliers. I'm going to grab on to the very end of the head pin. I'm going to grab on to the bead. Now this is going to be a little harder because this bead is smaller, but I do have the spacer bar here as a bit of leverage. I'm pushing down on the spacer bar, pulling up on the head pin, and now I'm going to bend that right angle. And I'm going to repeat this by stringing a bead on the other side and doing the same movement. I can now trim each of those wires. And again, leaving about the same amount of space. A little over a quarter of an inch. And I'm going to use my round nose pliers to grab on and roll that loop. You'll notice my loops are facing different directions. Oftentimes you can just fix that with your hand, and if you need to, you can use your chain nose pliers just to slightly turn your loop so that they are all in alignment. The outside wires are the most important. These are going to make the biggest difference in how tight my overall piece is. In this case, I'm just using a tiny daisy spacer just for a bit of embellishment, but so that my loop will rest a little bit lower than the others. I'll grab onto the end of the head pin, gently pull up, push down. Now one thing I do need to keep in mind is down here, it's just a loop. So if I pull too hard, sometimes that loop can open up and I can pull that whole pin out. So to avoid that, I am keeping an eye on the loop down here to make sure that it doesn't start to undo. And then I can bend my right angle. And I'm going to repeat on the other side. Now you'll notice on the other side, when I look down here at the bottom, I have a little gap of wire. That's what this whole procedure we're doing right here is trying to fix. So hopefully when I grab on and I push down, that little gap should disappear. So it tightens it right up. And now I can bend my right angle. And again, the same procedure. I'm going to trim my wire. And then I can pick up my round nose pliers and make a loop on each end. And there is my completed bottom. If it's out of alignment at all I need to do is pick up my chain nose pliers, and I can come in here and just straighten up my loops if I need to. You'll also notice on your side view, sometimes on the side view you'll find that you'll have a little curve. So for instance, your piece might look like this on the side. If that's the case, this is the time where we can fix it. You're just going to manhandle your piece a little bit here. If it's twisted on you at all, this is the time where you straighten it up. You're not going to do any harm to it. Everything is nice and secure. And then our final steps before we add the embellishment on the bottom is to deal with all these anchor wires we have in the back here. When you go to remove your anchor wires, you never want to accidentally cut off the wrong wire. So I always pull each of these tails out so I can see where each individual wire is coming from. Once I've determined all the wires that I need to cut, I'm then going to pick up my wire cutters. And I'm going to go in here. I want to keep the flush side, the flat side of my plier, up against my wire work. And I'm going to look closely to make sure that I'm not clipping the wrong wire. And then I can just cut that wire off. I can do them all at once or one at a time. Now, even after you've cut the wires, you'll see you can barely see those tails. But a lot of times you'll run your hand over where you've just cut and you can feel little nubs of wire ends. To fix this, you'll need to use your chain nose pliers and come in here and just ever so gently use your chain nose pliers to gently crimp down the little tail ends. Some of them can be hard to reach. For instance, this one on our wrap, it's on the inside, so there's no real way to grab onto it. So to access that one, I'll just use the tip of the plier to kind of push it into place. And my goal is to be able to run my finger over the back of my piece and not feel any of the little wire tails. And now, let me cut this last one here. Now I've cut this last one so there's just enough wire here to make sure that the little wire tail can get tucked around the back side of the piece. I always try to cut my wire tails on the back side of the piece so when you look at it straight on, there's no beginnings or endings. It just looks like a continual wire. So now I've completed and I'm ready to add my embellishment. Once you've finished your loops down at the bottom of your piece, you're then ready to add your final embellishment. I like to lay a lot of my beads out first before I decide what I want. In this case, I've gone ahead and chosen my beads. I put them on a head pin. I made a loop at each end. And now I'm just going to align it with the bottom of my piece so I can see, do I like how this looks? Do I want more fringe, less fringe? In this case, I'm going for kind of a small piece. I don't want my fringe to be too long. It's a long pendant in itself. You'll notice how the beads down at the bottom match the crown of my piece. If I turn my piece over, you'll see the very center embellishment is the same as the center embellishment on my crown. The other two vary slightly, but they use the same color configuration of the greens and the purples. When I go to attach, it doesn't matter which one you attach to. I like to start with my middle one first, because that's my best dangle. So I'll just open up the loop with my round nose pliers. Oops, sorry, with my chain nose pliers. I'm going to slide that loop onto the loop of my centerpiece. Then I'll use my chain nose pliers and I'm going to close that loop up tight. Usually at this point of the embellishment, I try not to open up the loops on the centerpiece bead itself. I can open those, but I do risk if I open them and then decide, oh, I don't like this fringe, and take it off and open them again, I risk the wire breaking. And if the wire breaks on these loops, that's the wire that's running through the entire piece. So I really want to protect these loops, and that's why I always pick up my embellishment pieces and open up the loops on those pieces. If I make a mistake and break a loop, I'd rather it be on a head pin wire that isn't connected to my centerpiece than one of my main frames. So I'm just going to attach all these embellishments down at the bottom, and then I'll be finished. I've now attached all of my embellishment dangles down at the bottom. I tend to go for a tapered look to complete my design, but a lot of it has to do with what my crown looked like on the top. You'll notice the crown is pretty tapered also. I have that high point in the center, so I have the low point down at the bottom. And now my pendant is complete. All that's left is to attach the string for a necklace, or in this case, chain. So if we zoom out here, you'll see that on this piece, I've just attached a sterling chain. That chain is attached to the loop on the end head pin. So you remember we had cut those heads off the head pin and made a loop, and it just attaches to that. And in this particular chain, I incorporated some beads that were used within the piece. So you'll notice I have some amethyst and jade, and it's just attached with a simple wire wrapped loop. And then at the clasp, I did the same thing, where I just attached the clasp to the chain using a simple wire wrapped loop. And again, I'm incorporating the same beads that I used in my pendant. And there you have it. You now have a completed basket weave wire centerpiece pendant and necklace.